And don't leave before the commercial. Because without this, you wouldn't have any reason to be here.
Amen.
Amen. And so I'll read to you tonight in Joel chapter 2. Amen. I'll begin with verse 28. See how this reads to your spiritual palate. And it shall come to pass that afterward I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Wonderful promises to everybody, isn't it? Sons, daughters, all flesh, old, young. Wonderful promises. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaidens. That's the people that specially wait on the Lord. That's the people that specially work for God. That's the people that they have no other purpose in life but to serve, and work for, and minister to the Lord. Praise God. There have been many down through the ages and shall be more to come. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaidens, in those days will I pour out of my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. It has only been just a very few short years since we saw our young men and young women, America's best, facing the dust, the lice, and the uncertainties of Desert Storm. In the wake of Desert Storm, we saw the smoke, the pictures of the smoke and fires of some 700 oil wells in Kuwait that blackened the earth and polluted the skies and blackened the land. Black snow fell, black rain fell, because everything in the air for hundreds of miles, amen, was polluted by the dread soot and the smoke of the fires of the oil wells of Kuwait in the wake of Desert Storm. Amen. Joel reads something like that in the previous chapters. God promises to scorch the earth. In that land in particular, amen, the land is going to be scorched. Amen. The beast of the field would cry, and the joy would wither away from the sons of men. The trumpet would be blown in Zion, that the inhabitants of the land might tremble. A day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains. A great people and a strong, there hath not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. Amen. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is the appearance of horses, and as horsemen so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on the tops of the mountains shall they leap, like the noise of a flame of fire that devours stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Before their face the people shall be much pain. All faces shall gather blackness. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war. They shall march every one on his ways, and they shall not break their ranks, neither shall they thrust another. They shall walk every one in his path, and when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. What kind of a horrible army is set to attack shortly in the future? So invincible a foe. He said, they shall run to and fro in the city and shall run upon the wall. They shall climb upon the houses. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars withdraw their shining. The Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great. For he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible. Who can abide it? It was then that he instructed them to turn to the Lord with their heart, and rend their heart, all their heart, with fasting and weeping, mourning, and rend their heart, and not their garments, and turn to the Lord your God. Amen. For he is gracious and merciful and slow to anger and of great kindness. Amen. The airwaves have been filled. AP wire photos have splashed the pictures of the latest tragedy of Oklahoma City on every newspaper and newsreel screen across the land. Amen. Yes, I'll show wonders in the heavens. Blood and fire. As we watch the pictures of blood-spattered babies. Yes, the innocents of Oklahoma City. The children that were killed. The innocent people standing by. Those that had gone with the friends to help them fill out their Social Security application. They didn't know they wouldn't be going home that day. Amen. Two girls standing side by side to get a Social Security card. 15 years old. One would be taken and the other left. She would hear her friend scream, amen, help me. And then she would disappear, never to be seen again. Does that sound anything like what the Bible says? One shall be taken and the other left. Amen. It sheds a new light upon the picture, doesn't it? Amen. Ah, yes. Picture, if you will, that the prophecy of God concerning the horrors of that great day is like a cycle, a gigantic wheel. Amen. Inside the tire of this wheel is all of the ingredients for the explosion. But just before the big blow comes, a knot comes on the tire. And periodically, in the cycle of the tire going down the highway, you hear a thump, 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 depending on how fast you're going. Amen. And so, every year now, amen. It was Waco just a couple of years ago or less. Amen. Our newspapers was filled with whole pages of pictures of the inferno of Waco. Once again, the innocents died. The children were burned with the grown-ups. Amen. Oh, yes. I picture the prophecies of the Word of God in a cycle. Amen. Like a knot on the tar. Every time one of these cataclysmatic happenings take place. Amen. Every time one of these great horrendous infernos take place, it's like the tire turning and a bump on the tire. We don't know which one will light the match for the big blow. Amen. Yes, the Antichrist is coming. But John saw the turning of the wheels in his day. And he said, even now, there are many Antichrists. Yes, Amen. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon into blood and the stars withdraw their shining. Amen. But already our airwaves are being filled with blood and fire and vapors of smoke. How in the world do you think they splashed that on the screen of the TVs in most of the homes in the United States of America? How do you think they got the AP wire photos? Amen. Yes, they transmitted it to a satellite, and the satellite in turn transmitted it throughout the whole country, so that anybody with a receiver could receive the picture. In other words, the air was full of the judgment, if you'll allow me to say so. These things are just forerunners of things to come. Inside the tire that's making its cycle, let me repeat, is the ingredients for the big blow. What is the ingredients? Sin, rebellion, Christ rejection, prayerlessness, amen, forsaking the assembling of ourselves together in the house of God, amen, failure to call on God and seek Him with all our heart, and failure to read His Word and do according to what the Bible said, and we're contributing to the swelling of that tire, that cycle of prophecy, if you will. Amen. It's like when I, amen, felt like finally I'd got direction from the Lord to go see my sick folks. Dad was in a veterans hospital, Poplar Bluff, and Mom was in a rest home. Amen. And out of sheer desperation, pastoring a church this size, not knowing what might happen, I have to feel after God till I get the all clear, because I don't know if someone might need me. Amen. And I felt like my thumb landed on what God wanted me to hear. Amen. Said, thou shalt go out and thou shalt fall into the hands of strangers. I didn't like it. Amen. But I paced back and forth and I prayed and I thought about what the Lord was trying to tell me, if it was the Lord. Amen. That's not always the Lord, I might remind you. You have to try the spirits. It might be your imagination. Amen. So you got to try the spirits upside down and backwards and forwards and backwards and again and again. You got to try the spirits. Amen. Finally, I come to this deduction. Lord, you said I'd go out. And if that was you that said I would certainly go out, then here I go, Lord, and I'm going to follow you one step at a time and see what happens. Amen. And well, I got all the way to Wickliffe, Kentucky, and I'd been feeling like my right front tire was going down. I had a low tire the way the car was driving. You can tell. You know that, don't you? Amen. And so I realized I had a leak of some magnitude, and I stopped at the station on the corner of 62 and Route 60, where they joined together again in Wickliffe, Kentucky, to cross the rivers. And I aired my tire up without an air gauge. I mean, I put a lot of air in it. I wouldn't put enough air in it, I'd get all the way to Arkansas. I mean, Salem, Arkansas, before I had to fix the tire. So I put a whole lot of air in it, Lawrence. Amen. I really aired her up. Amen. I put enough air in it that when I would go down the road, I could feel that thump, 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 thump. Every cycle of that tire, there was a thump. And every thump was a preliminary to the big one. Huh? Amen. Going down the highway about 60 miles an hour, 4 miles this side of Poplar Bluff, Missouri, where I would go see my dad, that right front tire exploded. Literally. It didn't slow down, blow out, go down. It blew up. It blew up so hard it blew the whole top out of the wheel well. You could open the hood and look down and see the ground. Amen. Where it blew the top out of the wheel well, did $140 damage under the hood. Amen. And the tire was so flat that I couldn't get my jack under it hardly. I ran clear out of threads, Brother Johnson, with my scissor jack that they sent that 81 Oldsmobile. And it wouldn't start. And so if I could get the jack up just a little bit, the threads would catch. But I laid it down so low to get it under the frame, the car was so low that the jack wouldn't catch. So here I am trying to jack the car and jack the jack and lift the car at the same time. And I couldn't do it. I couldn't lift that car with my left hand and crank that jack at the same time just to get an inch. But I couldn't do it. I looked around for some way to do it. Decided to put the spare in front of it, that little donut, and just drive up on top of it. With no one there to hold his foot against the spare to keep it from scooting down the shoulder of the road. Amen. It just pushed the spare right along in front of it. Crunch, crunch. It wouldn't even climb up on the little donut spare. If I'd have went fast enough, it would have probably got up on it. But if I'd have went that fast, I'd have drove clear over it. So I was back at my job again, Randy Jones. I sure needed, amen, help. And it didn't have to be too sophisticated neither. Amen. I was looking for a prize pole and a rock. That's what the hillbillies used to use for a jack for a Model T Ford. Amen. A prize pole and a rock. And they'd change a tire and go down the road. But there wasn't no poles and no rocks. I was in a swamp. And the frogs was croaking at me. Amen. And while I'm back at my job trying to figure out, I probably figured it out, but it took me a while to figure it out. A van swung around in front of me. Amen. And backed up. Old green van. And a young man, thin and spry, came out of that van. He said, "Can I help you, neighbor?" Here I am all humped over at my right front tire trying to get my jack started right behind the front tire on the frame. And I didn't tell him who I was. I didn't introduce myself or nothing. Amen. I said, if I could just lift my car an inch, my jack would catch and I could change this tire. Why, he said, I'll lift it for you. He didn't know me from a man in the moon. He grabbed a hold of my bumper and said, get ready. And he said, in the name of Jesus. Amen. And he lifted my jack and I got it started. I was so tickled to get the jack started, get the thing jacked up. Never thought about scotching the tire. Amen. To keep the car from rolling, and it started going forward. And kawham, down it came again on top of the jack and all. And I was right back, Brother Denver, at my job again. He said, don't worry about it. So get your jack ready. We'll get it this time. Still hadn't introduced myself to him. He said, in the name of Jesus. And I got it started this time with the tires, car scotched. Amen. Jacked it up. Never thought about loosening the lugs. And here I am with the tire all jacked up and it's turning around and around and around and around. Can't get the lugs loose. I said, would you mind going around sitting in the front seat while I loosen the lugs? And he said, sure. Bounded around the car, sat down the front seat, put his foot on the brake. Amen. When he came out, he said, well, he said, I see you're a Christian too. I saw your sword in the front seat. Talking about my Bible. He saw laying in the front seat. Amen. And then I introduced myself to him, loaded down with the highway holiness tapes. Amen. And when he got in his van, he didn't go on down the road. He turned around and went back the other way. Made me think that the Lord just sent him down there just for me. Amen. Ooh, you may not think angels drive old, dirty, rusty green vans, but he was an angel to me. Amen. I tell folks it's not so bad to fall into the hands of strangers if they've got their hands on your bumper lifting your car in the name of Jesus. Amen. That tire of a bump on it was preliminary to the big blowout. I want to tell you, everything that's happening, everything that's shaking us mentally and spiritually across the land, and incidentally with all kinds of laws against praying, praise God. I think Brother Gallagher or Brother Stanton mentioned it the other night. Amen. Everybody comes on the newscast, president and all of them, and says pray. Amen. If that's what it takes to get people to praying, I'm here to tell you that God's got plenty of that in the immediate future. Amen. He said, with this outpouring of the Spirit, I'm going to show wonders in the heavens, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. Amen. Peter repeated that in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2. Praise God. He repeats the whole prophecy of the book of Job, slightly paraphrased. Amen. Peter wasn't wrong. He wasn't misquoting Joel 2 and 28. Amen. No, he was just telling us what would really happen. The sun shall be turned. Let me go back a little further. I'll show wonders in the heavens above, signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. Where do you think that blood's coming from? Amen. You guessed it. People is where it's coming from. Aside from the fact that God is going to, in the book of Revelation, turn the waters into blood, there's going to be a whole lot of it that's going to come from people. Amen. Innocents, some of them. Amen. Yes, there were innocents that were burned up in Sodom and Gomorrah. That's why God said to Jonah later, when Jonah got upset because of his gourd vine being dried up. Amen. God said, you mean you're upset because of the gourd vine, and you're not concerned about 120,000 little kids that don't know their right hand from the left? If God had destroyed Nineveh, the little babies, and the 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 years old, and the 7-year-olds would have died with them. Amen. Our hearts were stirred as we saw blood-spattered babies in the hands of the rescuers. Amen. And that terrible tragedy in Oklahoma City. But folks, when men's sins reach the magnitude that they have today, one more time, the innocents perish. Isn't it amazing? While angels were singing and saints were welcoming the Son of God, Herod had the innocent babies, 2 years old and under, in Bethlehem, slaughtered. In the midst of great hope, in the midst of great fulfillment, in the midst of wondrous promise, God had sent His Son. But His coming had raised the ire of hell. And hell attacked. And when it attacked, it destroyed the innocence of Bethlehem. Amen. God is moving today, and the devil don't like it.
Amen.
Amen. There are a group of people that are immune in this conflict. Praise God. He said, I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, your sons and your daughters. May your sons and your daughters share in this divine blessing and, if you will, immunity. Amen. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see vision. And your old men shall dream dreams. And upon my servants and upon my handmaidens, I'll pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And incidentally, that's what I'm doing tonight. That's what Brother Hughes was doing a while ago when he said, you are a special people. Did you hear him say it? Amen. You are a special people. Praise God. God considers those that are faithful to the house of God and their attendance upon the Lord's house and His work a special people, and has promised special immunity to them. Amen. Yes. Glory to God. Before the big blow comes, God is going to take His special people out. Amen. This has also a fuller, more complete fulfillment in the great tribulation period, particularly in the first 3.5 years. God once again will pour out His Spirit upon Israel. See, this has never been fulfilled in the strictest sense of the word for Israel, because they rejected Christ. When they rejected Christ, the veil of the temple was rent, symbolizing the fact that the Lord had made His ascent from the Holy of Holies. Amen. Jesus said, "Your house is left unto you desolate from henceforth." Amen. Because they rejected Christ, the blessing would come to the church. But oh, woe be to Jerusalem. The wheel was rolling, and there was about to come another big bump in Jerusalem. It'd be so severe that blood would run like water in the streets. Millions would die. Amen. In AD 70. The last ones to hold out was on top of Masada, that Herodian fortress down on the Dead Sea. Amen. We've been there several times and toured those grounds, where 1,000 Jews with enough food and water to last from here on committed suicide because the Romans were sending up fellow Jews, and they were throwing their catapulted stones down upon their fellow Jews and killing fellow Jews. Amen. The ploy worked. Amen. The Roman general was victorious in a sense, but defeated in a sense. Rather than fall prey to the torture and death of the Roman general and give him the satisfaction of conquering them, 1,000 people committed suicide on Masada. Amen. Today they take the Jewish recruits from the army, the new soldiers, amen, to the top of Masada and blow the trumpet and shout, "No more Masada." They'll fight to the last ditch this time. Amen. They'll fight to the last man this time. And arising up out of Israel, amen, is a fierce army that is more fierce and effective than the Gurkhas of India that fought on the side of the English, amen, that wade into battle oblivious to the guns, oblivious to fear, amen. Those Jews have decided, "We have gone thus far and we'll go no farther." Amen. They've stuck their heels in. There's just one problem. They and those that persecute them, almost to the man, have rejected the Jesus Christ of God. Amen. The Muslims and the Arabs hate the Christians, and the Jews still hate Christ. And the elements are there for judgment to come in the Valley of Armageddon. Amazing thing, God is going to assemble the greatest army of unbelievers and God-haters the world has ever known in the Valley of Armageddon. The destruction will be so fierce that blood will run to the horses' bridles. Amen. And God shall win that victory in one day's time. Amen. In the midst of that terrible Holocaust that is yet to come, worse than Hitler's, if you please. Because Jesus said it'd be worse than anything that had ever been before it, or anything that would ever be thereafter. Such a day of tribulation. such a time of trouble. Can you believe that in the same breath he's talking about pouring out his Spirit upon a special people? Can you believe that in the tribulation period, in the first part of it, God is going to seal, pour his Spirit out upon 144,000 Jews and use them to evangelize what's left of the world of their time? Amen. And make them immune to the horrors of that day? Amen. Men today have the know-how. On a home computer, they can hook into other computers. And they can learn how to buy stuff at the grocery store and build a bomb. And they're doing it. Amen. The bomb that blew up the federal building in Oklahoma City was 4,000 pounds of fertilizer mixed with fuel oil with a detonator to strike the match. Amen. That's nothing, folks, compared to what it's gonna be when the church is gone. When the great restraining influence is gone. Amen. That's nothing compared to what it's going to be. I can't tell it all tonight. You would reach your saturation point. Amen. Of course, there's something wrong with our saturation point. Amen. I was in church Friday night, and Brother Pasquarella said, "I wish you'd go with me tonight." I said, "I'm going to a black church on Redding Road." And he said, "They don't start till 10:30. Oh, man, I was home sitting in my lazy boy by 10:30. Church was over. Amen. And I was already home. And the black folks were just getting ready to tune up. Amen. Woo! Hallelujah. Our saturation point is awful easy filled. We've heard everything. We've seen everything. We know everything. Great God, could it be? Amen. Instead of really knowing what we ought to know and feeling what we ought to feel, that we're just carnal. Amen. Glory to God. Oh, yes. Amen. We've seen so much. We've heard so much. We know so much. We get tired awful quick. Amen. But great God, the black folks are just getting ready to start at 10:30 Friday night. And I was already home. Amen. Getting ready, praise God, to go to bed. Hey, hallelujah. Woo, glory to God. What's it going to take to cause us to get down to business with God and quit playing church? What's it going to take? I'll tell you what's it going to take. It's going to take blood and fire. So far, all I've talked about is blood and fire. But there's another thing he mentioned. Vapors of smoke. Amen. We read about how that the Japanese subway was attacked by a cultish group that learned how, their scientists learned how to concoct poison gas. And they turned it loose on their own people in one of their own subways. Amen. If that wasn't enough, amen. Without, as far as we know, any foul play, we read in just a few days about the dreadful explosion in Seoul, Korea. A construction company burst a gas main. And the gas, vapors. Did the Bible say vapors? Oh, yes. There's all kind of vapors today that can fill the air, huh? And then we heard of an attempt, or a alleged attempt on Disneyland in Florida. Amen. One of our own buildings in New York, here in the United States, just a few short years ago, was blown up by a bomb. And immediately we thought of the Middle East when Oklahoma City had its Holocaust. It'll be a long time before Oklahoma City will repair the ruins of this one explosion. Amen. It'll be so bad in the future that the Bible says Israel will be 7 years burying the bodies. They had one earthquake in the Philippines. The same year, 5 months later, we was in the Philippines and went to Baguio. And we toured that place and we saw those buildings. Fine, big hotels and apartment buildings in Baguio that were leaning and cracked. No longer habitable because they'd been so damaged by the earthquake. 5 months later, with one crane working and a crew, they still hadn't got all the bodies out of the Hyatt on the hill. Amen. It's going to be so bad that 7 years Israel won't have all the bones buried. The destruction will be so bad that they won't even have to cut firewood for years. They'll just burn the relics left by the defeated armies of the Antichrist. Amen. But oh, there's that unseen, undetected vapors of smoke. That silent killer that you breathe it in your lungs and it affects your whole nervous system and you die in a fit of pain and agony. Amen. That's what it's going to take for God to salvage a remnant out of this old sin-soaked, rebellious world. That's what it's going to take, folks, to get people to praying and down to business. And did you know even then most of them won't pray? When the sun scorches men with great heat for months and they gnaw their tongues for pain, the book of Revelation said still they did not repent of their adulteries, their fornication, their sorceries, their wickedness. Amen. Beyond repentance, fodder for the fires of judgment. Amen. And little kids today will grow up to be grown folks tomorrow, to face blood, fire, vapors of smoke. My advice is to get ready for the rapture. You say you're using scare tactics. I wish I could. I can't paint the picture as bad as it is. If I could, you and me both wouldn't be able to get up off the floor. Daniel couldn't. He said, I was sick certain days when he saw it. Amen. John the Revelator fell flat on his face. God had to strengthen him. Amen. We cannot imagine tonight. You know where we are tonight? Amen. When things happen, we scan the airwaves looking for a new thrill. Amen. The newscast, NBC, ABC, and CBS. Amen. You know what they're looking for? They're looking for another O.J. trial. Amen. It'll cost the public millions of dollars. And they may then declare a mistrial. But the media is having a multi-million dollar heyday. Amen. We're like I was when I was a little boy going to the old Western movies. I hoped the Indians would win a little while because I didn't want the show to quit. I hoped the crooks would get away for a little while because I didn't want the show to be over. Because I knew just as soon as that man in that white horse and that white hat rode in and captured all the crooks. Amen. The show was over, popcorn and all. Amen. And so secretly, I had a little inhibited hope that he'd get away. Because I was getting a thrill. Amen. Out of the show. And we sat like children in an old time movie theater watching the things go before our eyes. As long as it don't touch us, as long as it's not our children, as long as it's not us that's being touched. But folks, The only ones that's going to remain untouched in that day are the sons and daughters of God, His servants and His handmaidens. Woo! And they're going to be enjoying the immunity of a heavenly outpouring while the world gets ready to burn. Stand with me tonight. Father, bless our broken remarks. Challenge our hardened hearts. Challenge our callous, jaded spirits. Oh God, open our mind. Oh Lord, trouble our prayers and dreams with the awesomeness, Lord, of being lost in this last time. I beg in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Holy Savior, we invite you to your altar of prayer, your place of commitment and sweet surrender. Would you like to be one of His servants? One of His handmaidens? One of His sons? One of His daughters? You can. You can be born again tonight. Come on. As they say, come to your altar. Come to your God. Come to your Savior tonight. Amen.